Hello, my name is Brad Langdale. I'm here to talk to you about projectile motion. I call this projectile motion type 2. It's the second type that I talk about in class. It looks kind of like this. So imagine you've got a cannon, and it's at some sort of angle, and it's going to be fired in the air, kind of like this, shooting that cannonball up, and it comes back down, makes kind of a nice little parabola, like so. And this is a great animation from the University of Colorado, the FET animation that shows this super well. We'll take off the air resistance here. We're going to try that again. And what I want to look for is those velocity vectors, those arrows. So watch these arrows carefully here. The arrow in the Y direction is changing size, but the arrow in the X direction is not. So we'll watch a little bit slower. The X direction here has uniform motion. The velocity is not changing. The Y direction has accelerated motion. It's changing all over the place. And we're going to use that idea as we go and solve this problem. So here's an example of a type of problem that we might try. I've got a potato gun. It's going to fire at 5 meters per second at 60 degrees. What's the range of the potato, which means how far does it go horizontally? First thing you want to do, draw out a diagram. I've got my velocity of 5 meters per second as my initial velocity, and it's a diagonal vector at 60 degrees up in the air. Then I've drawn in the X and Y components of the velocity. Notice those components are tip to tail. I've got the range, the displacement in the X direction, and I've got a final velocity, which is exactly the same as the initial velocity, same triangle, it's just the directions are all, mostly they're all backwards. The velocity is at a 60 degree angle going down. The Y velocity is going downwards instead of upwards. The X velocity is the same though. Again, uniform motion in the X direction, it doesn't change. And I also put in the height, if you need to calculate that in a different problem, we're not doing that here. Okay, diagram done. Next thing we're going to do, we got to break that 5 meter per second velocity into X and Y components. We won't actually ever use 5 meters per second in any physics formula in this problem. We use the X and the Y components. So I use trig to get my Y component and my X component, like you can see there, nothing too fancy. I recorded the decimal places down to 4 digits. This one worked out to exactly 2.5, so there's no more digits after that. And I color-coded them as well, so I made sure that I didn't accidentally mix up an X and a Y later on when I did some calculations. All right, first calculation I do, I'm going to get the time. Get that out of the Y dimension. So I'm going to use an accelerated motion formula, because in that animation we saw how the Y direction had accelerated motion. I'm using just the regular old acceleration formula. Acceleration is final velocity minus initial velocity divided by time. I put in the acceleration due to gravity. I actually typed it in as 9.1 instead of 9.81, but there we go. That looks better now. The final velocity is negative 4.3301. Now that's negative because, again, from the diagram you can see it's going downwards. The initial velocity is positive 4.3301. And because those are both negative, well, the first one's a negative, the second one's a positive, when I subtract them it doesn't give zero. It's going to give, you know, double that amount, 8.6602 meters per second. Go through, solve that for time, I'm getting about 0.8828 seconds. Now, I made that purple because time isn't really an X component or a Y component. It's a scalar, not a vector. So I didn't want to make it blue like the Y components, and I didn't want to make it red like the X. Okay, now we know how long that object was in the air for in total. Next and last step, I'm going to figure out how far it goes horizontally. Now, in the X direction, the horizontal direction, it's going to be uniform motion. So I'm using just V equals D over T. And notice I'm not using the 5 meters per second. I'm using the 2.5 meters per second vector. I got to keep my X with my X. So if I want to figure out how far horizontally the projectile goes, I have to use the velocity in the horizontal or X direction. The time that I solved from the last part of the problem, I'm going to plunk in there. I'm going to solve this, and I get 2.2 meters. So I think the key to this one is really to remember the X and Y dimensions. A lot of students have trouble because they will accidentally start off here by not thinking about breaking that 5 meters per second down. So I hope that helps. If you're looking for more problems and practice with this idea, you can check out the website at ldindustries.ca.